got the cable news blues? Try Rational Radio, The Rick Unger Show.
Welcome back to The Rick Unger Show. As you are no doubt aware, shortly following the conclusion of our program today, there is going to be not one town hall, but two town halls. One, of course, on ABC featuring Vice President Joe Biden, and one on NBC featuring the president, Donald J. Trump. Now, what makes this somewhat, well, it's unusual right from the outset. We all know it was supposed to be a town hall, but with the two of them participating, that went away last week, largely due to Trump's coronavirus concerns, not his concerns, but the concerns that those who organized the debates had. And in as a result, you ended up with both of them scheduling a town hall. Now, what makes it a bit weird is that NBC agreed, I suspect, to schedule the town hall with Trump at the identical time as the town hall with Biden. What a waste, from my point of view, that is. Here to talk about what we can expect this evening is Bernard Whitman. Bernard is a Democratic strategist. He is the founder and CEO of Whitman Insight Strategies. Bernard, great to have you on the program.
Thanks for having me, Rick. Appreciate it.
So what do you make of this? Were you surprised that NBC would agree? And I say agree because my expectation is, knowing how Trump thinks, that he wanted to have a direct ratings battle with Joe Biden. He wanted to be able to come out of this and say, hey, look, I got tons more viewers than Joe did. And NBC would have had to have gone along with that. What do you think? Was that a wise thing to do?
On NBC's part, I mean, look, unfortunately, you know, NBC is playing the role of Trump's patsy. The fact is, we did some polling on this very recently, right, just a couple days ago, and we asked people, does it make Trump look strong or weak, the fact that he pulled out of the debate? Three quarters of people agree that the debate should have been virtual. Two thirds of the people, including two thirds of independents and even almost a third of Republicans, say Trump's decision to pull out of the debate makes him look weak. So he has spent now, you know, 2 weeks since Corona trying to project this image of strength, a strong man like all the strong man authoritarian dictators that he cozies up to. And in fact, the singular biggest thing that he's done of late is pull out of debate, which just makes him look weak. It makes him look scared. It makes him look afraid. And, you know, at the end of the day, NBC is going to go for where the ratings are. I sort of can't really fault them too much for trying to make a buck. But it's unfortunate. And, you know, I'm reminded of a baseball analogy. It's sort of like, you know, Trump's handlers, and Trump himself probably is scared. They realize he's not ready for prime time. He's not ready to face Joe Biden. He's not ready to face the voters. Remember, that was going to be a town hall. He's not ready to face the voters. And in fact, so instead of going toe to toe with Biden, they're putting him down to double or triple A ball for a rehab start and to see how he does before, you know, potentially goes against Biden mano a mano next week.
That's an interesting way to put it, and I think it's very accurate. So I don't have any objection to NBC giving Trump the airtime so that he can hold a town hall. My objection very much comes, look, I mean, I understand, too, they're there to make money. But at the same time, they have a public service obligation, particularly NBC News. And all they did was very much cut the number of Americans who could hear from both of the candidates. Most people can't watch both of them at the same time. So, I mean, that's what I found to be disturbing. I don't understand why NBC wouldn't say, yeah, we'd be more than happy to carry your town hall, Mr. President, but we're going to start it an hour earlier or an hour later.
Well, you know, it's funny. Back in the day, everyone used to call Reagan the Teflon president because nothing stuck to him. Trump is far more, is far worse. It's much more insidious. He's like a tractor beam that attracts people's attention and they can't let go. Look at the Republican establishment. Look at the GOP. They have, you know, time and time and time and time again excused his behavior, excused his outrageous tactics, excused his disgusting policies and his demeanor and the way he conducts business, the way he's conducted the country, to sort of let him get away with whatever he wants to get away with, including allegations of the vote is basically going to be rigged, it's going to be fraudulent, it's going to be inaccurate unless he wins. NBC is doing the same thing. NBC is playing the role of the GOP, not questioning him, not pushing back, letting him do whatever he wants, letting him get away with it. And I just think that, and I'm hopeful that the American public is finally seeing through this, and there are enough fair-minded people, fair-minded independents, and a handful of reasonable conservatives that say, you know what, enough is enough. this guy is a fake, he's a fraud, he's a phony, he's dangerous, and we're not going to take it anymore.
So that raises the question of what we'll see in Trump tonight, and I'm going to ask you that question. First, I want to let anybody who's just joining us know we are discussing the dueling town halls that are set to take place shortly, in fact, this evening, one on NBC with President Trump, the other on ABC with Joe Biden, and we are discussing this with Bernard Whitman, Democratic strategist. Bernard, so what demeanor do you expect from the president tonight? We know from the polls that he really has yet to recover from the way he handled himself in the first presidential debate. What do you expect to see? Will he be interrupting Savannah Guthrie and doing the same Trump thing, or do you expect to see a mellower, more under control Donald Trump?
Well, I can tell you all of his advisors and his and some of his base that's sort of way, you know, aware is hoping that they see Trump of 2016 that's consistently on message, that's harping on things like he did in 2016 about, you know, immigration and trade and Hillary Clinton's emails, which you can't seem to get over now. I think you're going to see an erratic Trump. I think you're going to see a Trump that's there to air grudges. I think you're going to see a Trump that's sort of trying to make make himself feel better. Look how many people are watching. Look how strong I am. I beat Corona. I mean, the truth is his campaign has been done nothing but dissemble and raise the infection rate among American people. Look at the states right now. All but two states, I think, have infection rates that are steady or climbing. Rudy Giuliani says the other day that no one's dying of the virus anymore. 1,000 people died yesterday, Rick. 1,000 people died. This is going to be a president tonight who pretends that the American economy is where it was a year ago, the coronavirus never happened, that everything is fine, and that he is continues to be the right man for the job. It's almost as if he's operating in a parallel universe where the economy hasn't tanked, where jobless claims aren't rising, where Americans aren't dying by the thousands a day. And he's selling this vision to the American people. And for some reason, his base is still buying it.
Yes, his base is still buying it, which leads me to wonder, is that who's going to be watching him tonight? Or is he going to get a larger audience because other people, I know I'm going to be tuning in, other people want to see how he comports himself, to see if he's learned anything from that first debate, or will they just look forward to the entertainment value of what we got from Trump in that first debate?
Well, you know, my expectation is that Trump's ratings will be higher than Joe Biden.
Yeah,
but,
mine
you know, it's
too.
Interesting. When we looked at the RNC and the DNC, the two conventions, everybody thought, oh, you know, the Republican numbers are going to be much bigger than the Democrat numbers. That's not true.
No, it wasn't.
The Democratic convention got far more viewers than the Republican convention. I think people are going to be curious how Trump behaves, what he has to say, what he looks like. You know, I mean, it's sort of like a carnival sideshow, a freak show. You can't help but look. So I think a lot of people are going to be sort of wondering on that. And I think a lot of people are going to be switching back and forth. And it does a disservice to the American people, because at the end of the day, this is a choice between two competing visions of the future. And unfortunately, because of Trump acting like a petulant child, taking all his marbles and going home, or going to NBC in this case, we're not going to get an ability to sort of see Biden and Trump go toe-to-toe. And I think that's, as you pointed out, quite unfortunate for democracy.
It really is, and very disappointing on NBC's part. So in the short time that we have left, let's talk about what we can expect from Joe Biden tonight.
You know, I think Joe Biden has done an incredible job of staying on message. I mean, you know, what I want to hear from Joe Biden, what I expect to hear from Joe Biden, is to hit the economy again and again and again. We just saw the jobs report today, almost 900,000 people claiming unemployment. So unemployment numbers are continuing to rise, the highest weekly job claims in 6 or 7 weeks. I think he's got to hit that hard. I think he's got to hit healthcare hard. I mean, we have Trump trying to ram through, and unfortunately, likely successfully ramming through, a Supreme Court justice who is going to end Obamacare if she has the opportunity, and potentially end this election and put Trump back in the White House, which I'm particularly worried about. I think Biden tonight has to hit hard on the economy, has to hit hard on healthcare, and has to hit hard on who is actually finally going to stand up and give some coordinated national policies to this pandemic, so we can actually bring down infection rates, bring down death rates, bring down hospitalizations, and get the economy moving again, instead of pretending it just is going to resurge on its own.
So I've agreed with everything you've said, Bernard, except for one thing. I don't think Amy Coney Barrett is going to vote to end Obamacare. In fact, I think there are just two justices on the court who will vote that way. I think Alito will, and I think Thomas will, and I don't think any of the others will, because it is one of the worst cases I have ever seen. I don't think that they'll buy into the case.
Well, as my mother is fond of saying, from your lips to God's ear, I hope she does not. I wish she wouldn't have a chance to vote on it.
That's another story.
But, you know, maybe, you know, Roberts can buttonhole her and say, you know, come on, let's have some sense here. A, it is constitutional, and B, it would be the wrong thing to do.
And you can easily sever the provision. So, you know.
Yes.
All right. So in the 30 seconds that we have left, does this debate tonight have any impact on the race, considering that we're not going to have comparative points of view tomorrow?
You know, my gut says stasis. Joe Biden is, you know, 10, 11, 12 points ahead, 12 points in our recent poll. Is that going to narrow? Of course it is. But he's ahead significantly in swing states. He's ahead by double digits with women, 2-1 with women. He's ahead significantly, almost 2-1 among seniors. I think it continues to lock things into place, absent sort of major gaffes on either side. Right. You know, Trump has a gaffe. It's not going to really change things because, you know, his supporters are so forgiving.
Right.
I continue to see the race heading where it's been, which is incredibly stable until Election Day. Don't forget, 15 million people have already voted.
All right, we will leave it there for time. Bernard Whitman, Democratic strategist. He is the founder and CEO of Whitman Insight Strategies. Bernard, great insight, great talking to you. Thanks for joining.
Thanks so much for having me, Rick. I appreciate it.